Ladies and gentlemen, I am very pleased to welcome you to the Technion's Honorary Doctorate Ceremony for the year 2011. My name is Alfred Brookstein, and I am a professor of computer science at the Technion. I am honored and pleased to serve as your master of ceremonies for this evening. Like all universities, the Technion is pleased to award its honorary degree upon distinguished individuals whose contribution to society and the sciences have been truly exemplary. Tonight, we recognize 9 such outstanding individuals. Please rise to receive the academic procession, the honorary doctorate recipients, members of the Presidium, and of the Technion Senate. Chairman of the Board of the Governors of the Technion, Mr. Lawrence Jakir. President of the Technion, Professor Peretz Lavi. Chairman of the Council, Mr. Yoram Alster. Senior Executive Vice President, Professor Paul Fagin. Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs, Professor Moshe Sidi. Dean of the Graduate School, Professor Moshe Spitalny. Members of the Board of Governors, members of the Senate, members of the Technion family, colleagues and guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2011 Technion Honorary Doctorate Ceremony. I now wish to present this year's recipients of the Honorary Doctorate. Please rise as I call your name. Professor Alain from France. Dr. Edith Cresson from France. Dr. Moshe Epstein from Israel. Mr. Alan Forman from the United States of America. Professor Solomon W. Golomb from the United States of America. Professor Thomas Kailath from the United States of America. Mr. Yaacov Kotlicki from Israel. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Eitan Wertheimer from Israel. You may all be seated, thank you very much. I now invite Professor Peretz Lavi, the president of the Technion, to offer his greetings.
Honorary doctorate recipients and their guests, Mr. Larry Jakir, chairman of the Board of Governors, members of the Board of Governors, Mr. Yoram Alster, chairman of the council, Professor Paul Fagin, executive senior vice president, Professor Moshe Sidi, executive vice president for academic affairs, Professor Spitalny, the Dean of the Graduate School, and our MC, Professor Brookstein. Distinguished guests, members of the Technion administration, deans, members of the faculty, and friends. Universities bestow honorary doctorates to encourage a standard of excellence and innovation which is exemplary to students, faculty, staff, and to society generally. This ceremony, whose origin is to be found in the 15th century, universities recognize and salute feats of outstanding distinctions and achievements. The individuals we are honoring tonight represent what I see as the two major missions of the Technion: academic excellence and scientific leadership, and social responsibility. Four of our recipients this evening are leaders in science and technology. Excelling in science and technology is the prime goal of every research university. The fame of universities and their world status are measured by their contribution to science and technology. Scientific discoveries that change the way we perceive our world and technologies that change our daily life have immortalized their inventors. They become part of the Science and Technology Hall of Fame. We have examples of such paradigm shift discoveries in the Technion itself. Our Nobel laureates, distinguished Professor Hershko and Chicanover, and their world famous research, distinguished Professor Danny Schechtman, discovery of the quasi-periodic crystals, distinguished Professor Ziv and Professor Avram Lempel, this compression algorithm that paved the way for the information technology revolution, or the discovery of the embryonic stem cells, in which Professor Joseph Itzkovich took an important part. From the quality of the young faculty that we have joined the Technion in recent years, I'm convinced that more breakthrough discoveries and seminal technologies are in the store for us in the future. Our honorary recipients belong to this group of scientific leaders that left their footprints on the sands of scientific history, each in his own field. But the Technion bears yet another responsibility, a national one. Though thanks to the Technion graduates, Israel is thought of as a startup nation and a powerhouse of innovation, there is yet another Israel. An Israel where children and teenagers don't study any of the core subjects at school, subjects that are so crucial for their understanding of the world and so vital for any professional education they may obtain later. An Israel with underprivileged populations who do not have the opportunity to enjoy the cultural richness that is so readily available to the economically strong sections of the Israeli populations. We at the Technion see the accessibility of higher education to underprivileged population as one of the Technion national tasks. Our Center of Pre-Academic Education, headed by Professor Gepstein, is doing incredible work by teaching hundreds of young women and men for which the idea of studying at the Technion was a distant dream. This center opened the Atidim program, which enables youth from peripheral areas to obtain higher education. In the framework of the center, you can also find the Ofakim program, which allows veteran soldiers to access to higher education. We also have a program for the ultra-Orthodox and minorities that never have envisioned studying at the Technion possible. It is heartwarming to visit our Center for Pre-Academic Education and see young women and men who are thirsty for knowledge, young women and men for whom science and technology is suddenly within reach. The vision of closing the social gap in modern Israel is shared by the other recipients of the honorary doctorate this evening. Their names are directly linked with these important programs that open the ivory gate of higher education for thousands who could not but dream about it before entering our center. With your permission, I'd like to read a short passage taken from a letter written by one of the alumni of these programs who barely graduated high school and today is on his way to the faculty's dean's list. The truth is that what can be summarized by the words "dean's list student at the Technion" is not something I take for granted. I can further say that even being simply called a student was a dream for me. After all, there is a limit on how far you can dream. Excelling in his army service was what brought this student his self-confidence back. He came from a broken and poor home, and in the center of pre-academic education, it was made clear to him, yes, he could do it. The common thread for all of our recipients is leadership. Whether or not they were out there in the front, in a formal way, their actions were visible and set the standards for others, whether in science, in social responsibility, in politics, and in philanthropy. Our honorees for the honorary doctorates are Professor Alain Aspect from France, who has astounded the world of physics with his theories. Dr. Edith Cresson, a former prime minister of France, supporter of the Technion, who dedicated to promote cooperation between France and Israel. Dr. Moshe Epstein, who has used his prodigious talents for the benefits of science and the security of the state of Israel. Alain Forman, a true friend of the Technion, whose devoted service and generosity have made a difference. Professor Solomon Golomb from the United States, who has enriched us with his mathematical brilliance. Professor Thomas Kailath from the United States, whose path-breaking research has re-engineered communications. Yaacov Kotlicki, a most generous friend of the Technion, who pays special heed to disadvantaged students. And Mr. Eitan Wertheimer, an Israeli industrialist who manifests a deep commitment to our society and especially to students. Dear honorary doctorates, tonight your name is added to a very long list of distinguished recipients. You have been joined to the Technion family with immutable bonds, and we are delighted to have you as one of us. I congratulate you in the name of the Technion and all those present here this evening, and wish you continued productivity and achievements. May you go on inspiring us, and may the beacon of your excellence and accomplishments serve as a light for us in wartime and in best of times. Congratulations, and thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Lavie. I now invite Mr. Lawrence Jacquier, our Chairman of the Board of Governors, to deliver his greetings.
Erev Tov, good evening. President Peretz Lavie, distinguished members of the dais, honorary doctoral recipients, members of our outstanding faculty, friends and family of the Technion. As the chairman of the board, I get to speak a number of times throughout this Board of Governors meetings. The issue is, of course, finding the right words for the event without detracting from the occasion or in any way not paying the rightful respect to the audience and tonight to the persons whom we honor. At the festive opening ceremony yesterday evening, as well as giving honor to our honorary fellowship awardees, I asked the world, where would the world be without Israeli know-how? And how can they put Israel under attack and deny its right to exist? Through such attacks, albeit sometimes indirectly, the very institution that we support, the Technion, itself comes under attack. This morning at the opening plenary, I referred to the issue of creating future leadership, which I suggested would be the challenge that would have been set before us by two very, very great men, the late Mr. Henry Taub and the late Justice Moshe Landau. I refer again to these two issues this evening by way of paying tribute to our honorary doctorate awardees. When something or someone comes under attack, whether it be a country, a person, or an idea, one of the easiest things to do is to disassociate oneself from the subject of the attack. That is what many people do. In many cases, they are our enemies, but that is not always the case. In many, many more cases, they are ordinary people, just like ourselves, who choose to walk away. And we only know too well the effect of ordinary people walking away. Similarly, as our sages teach us, when we are surrounded by darkness, we have two choices. We can curse the darkness, or we can light a candle. Every one of our honorary doctorate candidates, I know, would always choose to light a candle. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, on this stage, we are about to honor a group of people who have not walked away and who do light candles every single time. No matter what field of endeavor they are from, they have remained in our constellation and have become our stars, having contributed so much to our great institution and therefore as well to the land of Israel. Equally, they have come to the fore not only to become leaders in the present, but also to pass on their knowledge and their strength to the future. Some have taught many students in the world of academia. Some have led through their role in government. And some have shown their talents through Jewish and Israeli communal, industrial, and business affairs. No matter how they have earned our honor here this evening, they have contributed to the advancement of the world and ensured that what they have established will be maintained in the future. This is the true definition of leadership. The Talmud teaches us, it is not the place that honors the person, but the person that honors the place. In the case of our awardees, each and every one has brought their endeavors to a presence that demands respect in their role in life. But they have done so not by self-proclamation or chasing after covet or award. What they have achieved for the sake of doing good. They desired no payment or glory. They have gained our respect by the honor that they have given to the Technion, to which they have been so deeply committed. They have honored the place that now honors them. Our honorees come from the world of academia and government, from the world of Jewish and Israeli communal, industrial, and business affairs. They are true leaders. Tonight they receive from us what I would say, and I would hope that they would agree, is their highest honor. That is our respect and our honorary doctorate. In Hebrew, Doctor L'shem Kavod, doctor for the sake of honor. Members of the Technion family, on your behalf, I thank our honorees for having given us the opportunity to honor them in our own special and unique way. I thank you all for being here at this evening in tribute and joining me in wishing a hearty mazel tov to all of our honorary doctorates.
Thank you, Mr. Jakir. To begin the conferment of the honorary degrees, I call upon Mr. Yoram Alster, Chairman of the Technion Council, to read the formal announcement of the honorary doctorate recipient.
The Board of Governors of the Technion Israel Institute of Technology, by virtue of the authority granted to it by the Constitution of the Institute and in accordance with the decision made by the Council on the 14th day of Tevet, 5771, the 21st day of December 2010, and with the approval of the Senate, hereby confers upon Professor Alain from France, Dr. Edith Cresson from France, Dr. Moshe Epstein from Israel, Alan Forman from the United States, Professor Solomon Golomb from the United States, Professor Thomas Kailath from the United States, Mr. Yaacov Kotlicki from Israel, and Mr. Eitan Wertheimer from Israel, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa, given in Haifa on the 11th days of Sivan, 5771, the 13th days of June, 2011, in the 64th year of the independence of the State of Israel. Signed by Professor Peretz Lavi, President, Mr. Lawrence Jakir, Chairman of the Board of Governors, Yoram Alster, Chairman of the Council. Congratulations.
Thank you. We shall next begin the conferment of the honorary doctorate. And now I call upon Professor Alain Aspect of France to please rise. In tribute to your fundamental contributions and outstanding scientific achievements in the fields of quantum mechanics and optics, in gratitude for your education of generations of students to continue making significant contributions to world-changing technologies, in recognition of your outstanding leadership in the scientific community, and in gratitude for your friendship and support of the Technion and Israel. Thank you. I now invite Professor Aspect to approach the podium and Professor Paul Fagin to present the scroll. I would now like to invite Professor Aspect to respond.
Well, those who know me know I would have been disappointed. Mr. President, dear colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen, it's a real great honor to be bestowed an honorary doctorate of such a prestigious institution as Technion. And I gratefully thank you, Mr. President, as well as the committee who made the decision. Beyond that personal honor, I am especially pleased because I think it gives a very positive signal and message about Technion. Bestowing an honorary doctorate to somebody who has devoted all his efforts to elucidating the weirdness of quantum mechanics means that Technion, an institution worldwide famous for engineering and technology, also knows that technology at its best level cannot be separated from basic science. You all know, of course, that laser is a fruit of fundamental research on the quantum nature of light and its interaction with matter, and that physicists who invented it had no idea that it would be one day be used to read barcodes in supermarkets or for high-speed information transfer in optical fibers. I could tell many similar stories about the transistor being invented by physicists striving to understand the quantum nature of electricity, about nuclear magnetic resonance imaging as a byproduct of the most fundamental studies on nuclear magnetism, etc. And I could recall that when asked by William Gladstone, the British Minister of Finance, about the practical value of electricity, Michael Faraday replied, "One day, you may tax it, sir." It was 1850. I could tell you more stories, but I will rather tell you my personal views on the relationship between basic science and applications. Nowadays, it's more fashionable to name it innovation. Okay. The link is obvious and does not demand to be elaborated. But what is not obvious is that it is the same kind of minds who can make breakthrough in fundamental science and who can think of groundbreaking applications. There may be exceptions, of course, but my personal experience is that it requires totally different ways of thinking, rarely found in the same individual. As far as I am concerned, I'm not gifted at all for thinking of application of the weird properties of quantum mechanics that I have contributed to unveil, such as entanglement or wave-particle duality for a single photon. I gave a talk in the physics department today about that, okay? But what I know is that it is by thinking over such results that smart minds, smarter than me, have developed basic ideas of the quantum computer and quantum cryptography. Some of them have already started making money with it. Not with quantum computer, with quantum cryptography. Nobody knows whether the quantum computer will work or not. But quantum cryptography works. You can buy one. This is why I always accept to give general lectures in places like MIT, Technion, or my institute, the Institute Optique, which is also an engineering institute, where a significant fraction of the students have innovation-oriented minds. And I also accept to give public lectures, and I have a dream. The dream that someday a layman gets, just by listening to me, gets the idea of application as simple and trivial, but as useful as code bar readers. This is why I form my warmest wishes for Technion to develop more than ever as a place where basic science and technology progress at the same pace, and where people with minds of the two kinds have the everyday opportunity to bump into each other. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I wish to thank Professor Aspe for his wonderful response. And I'm sure that our government has already paid attention to it, and they are going to tax every quantum particle possible inside. Exactly, and every quantum bit. Okay, let's continue. I call upon Dr. Edith Cresson of France to please rise. In acknowledgement of your unwavering support of the French Technion Society and of the Technion, in tribute to your long and active leadership in scientific cooperation between French and Israeli scientists, in gratitude for your service as Prime Minister of France and in many other political and social leadership positions on the local and national levels, and in recognition of your tireless work in encouraging others to follow your example of deep devotion to the Technion and Israel, and particularly your role in promoting Israel's membership in the European R&D Framework Program. Professor Fagin, please present the scroll. I invite now Dr. Edith Cresson to please respond.
Shalom is the only word I know in your language, so I didn't understand everything. But anyhow, I'm very grateful to President Lavie and the board and everybody for this distinction, which is absolutely wonderful. And besides, as you know, I'm not a scientist, so I have always the feeling that I don't deserve it completely. But anyhow, you were kind enough to think of me on this day to give this very important and a wonderful distinction. Well, it is true that the Technion in France is doing very well, as you know. There are different elements. Muriel Toiti is the main one, certainly. The Technion is now in several towns, cooperating with very important structures, laboratories, and doing very well. And when I visited the Technion today, I went to some labs and saw some French people who are here. So the exchanges are very important and very good. I'm very pleased of that. And it is true that the action of the Technion is also, we also have the action of the Foundation for France-Israel, which has been founded by President Jacques Chirac, in order to develop more exchanges and having more relations between our two countries. And this is, of course, quite an important thing. And we try to do our best, giving each year a prize to some students, scientific students from Israel and from France. So this is another action that we are doing. But as you mentioned it, I had the feeling when I arrived at the European Commission about 10 years ago, the members, the country women members of the European Union were members, of course, of the research programs. This was normal. And each year there were tenders, and those countries have to cooperate, at least two of them, in order to answer the tenders. And when I came to Israel, I often came, I had the feeling, well, it's a pity that Israel is not with us. After all, we have the same culture. I sometimes wonder what would have been the culture and the intellectual life of Europe if we had had no Jews? It's a question. So we think, I think, perhaps because we have the most important Jewish community in Europe, that we're very sensitive about this problem and that we want to have links. And those links, of course, can be in all sorts of areas, but mostly in the scientific area. So I made the program. I tried to convince my partners inside the European Commission. It's not always very easy. Saying, well, Israel is not a member of the European Union, but it's very interesting what's going there. And perhaps it would be a good thing to cooperate. It would be good for us, good also for them. It's a win-win organization. And why not try to do it? Well, I was just surprised that nobody else had the idea before. It seems so normal, so natural. Well, after some problems, we went to an agreement. And now today, it works very well. You have very good representatives in Brussels that work very well. And they do the things that have to be done in order to explain what you do to the members of the Commission. So this is, of course, an achievement I'm very proud of, because we need Israel, we need the searchers, we need to have good links, we need to work together, and we need to try to prepare the future together, because this is the challenge. The challenge in the years that are coming, you know them in the world. It's the problem of food, of water, of energy, of health. And in those areas, of course, Israel is very much in advance. And we, in Europe, where we have quite good scientists, it's a very good thing to cooperate together. And lots of towns in France have cooperation, lots of universities, and it's, I think, a great challenge and a great progress. If we want to prepare the world of tomorrow, we've got to prepare it together. And I think it would be extremely mean and poor and a very negative thing if France and Europe did not cooperate very actively with Israel. So I hope this cooperation will go on. I hope a great success to this cooperation, and I want to thank you once more for what you decided, for me, who I'm not a scientist, as I said, but I saw somebody who tried to put people together in order to shape the future of the world, which you are preparing here in your labs, in your schools, and not only in the scientific point of view, because I visited the school that you have in order to prepare those youngsters who come from areas where they don't have any preparation for scientific studies or university studies, and you try to put them to the level in order that they can enter the Technion. I think this is a great achievement. So on all those points, we have lots of things to do together, and thank you so much.
Merci beaucoup, beaucoup.
I call upon Dr. Moshe Epstein of Israel to please rise. In admiration for your vision, drive, talent, and inspiring imagination, as both an innovator and a true Renaissance man, in appreciation of your contribution as a teacher and a role model for generations of researchers and developers, in recognition of your work as a gifted inventor and scientist, and in honor of your contribution to the State of Israel and its security through extensive activity over many years in various positions in this arena. Be'okara al trumatcha kemamtzi ve'keish eshkolot ba'al chazon ba'al meretz kishurim ve'dimayon me'orer ashra'a ba'aracha al trumatcha kemore ve'keish mofet שהעמיד דורות של חוקרים וממציאים על פועלך כמדען וכממציא מבריק, וברחשי תודה על תרומתך למדינת ישראל ולביטחונה במסגרת פעילותך רבת השנים במגוון תפקידים בתחום זה. Please, Professor Paul Feigin, present the scroll. I invite Dr. Epstein to respond.
President Lavie, Board of Governors, distinguished award recipients, ladies and gentlemen, family and friends. 1944 was my first year in the Technion. At that time, the Technion was still small, only few faculties. However, many graduate students became good engineers. we got good foundation in theory and practice. At that year, the students decided to make a water jet in the garden for the annual students' ball. We asked two professors of hydraulics for advice. One said, I need the water network of the area, length and size of pipes, water pressure, location of water tower, and so on. Then I will calculate the size of the hole needed at the end of the water pipe. The second professor said, go to Hachalut Street, to the shop of Kaluzhny, buy a standard faucet, fix it on the pipe, and turn it open until you get the desired height. My lesson was, there are cases in which calculation is required, and cases in which common sense is the tool to be used. In 1948, I received a BSc, bachelor's. Because of the War of Independence, the diploma examination was delayed, and only in 1950, I got my engineering diploma. During the years, I guided engineers that worked with me and gave design courses in the Faculty of Aeronautics in the Technion. I advocate that every design should be simple, reliable, not expensive, looking at the project as a whole. In order to educate managers that always before starting a new R&D, that's research and development project, wanted to know what will be the cost, performance, and time to completion. I formulated what is known today as Epstein's uncertainty principle in R&D management. Three parameters characterize all R&D projects: tasks, resources, and time to completion. The uncertainty principle says that only two of the three parameters can be defined simultaneously in advance. If you know the task and the time to completion, you cannot predict the cost, etc. So now, in the rare cases when all three variables are apparently predictable, the task is not an R&D project. A saying that I use quite often is, of all the systems that do nothing, the cheapest is the best. And you can figure. Yeah. Though I got years ago the master's and doctorate degrees from Stanford University in California, I am completing today my academic circle in the Technion with the honorary doctorate, for which I am deeply grateful. Thank you.
It turns out that you can learn as much in an honorary doctorate ceremony as you can learn in a whole course in the management engineering department. Thank you very much. I now call upon Alain Forman from the United States to please rise. In recognition of your outstanding contributions to the future of Technion and Israel, in tribute to your generosity to the Technion, especially as evidenced in the Alain and Tatiana Forman and Family Immunology Genetic Research Laboratory and the Sonis and Forman Family Center of Excellence for Stem Cell and Tissue Regeneration Research, and the scholarships and fellowships you have funded, and in acknowledgement of your influential leadership in the American Technion Society over many years. Mr. Paul Fagin, Professor Fagin, please present the scroll. Dr. Forman, respond. I invite Mr. Forman to respond.
President Levy, Yoram Alster, Larry Jackier, members of the International Board of Governors, my fellow honorees, distinguished professors, of whom are Mishpacha, the brilliant students, the Technion staff that makes all of this possible, family and friends from around the globe. It's with great satisfaction and personal naches to celebrate with all of you this evening. I'd like to personally thank a special Technion alumni, my brother and business partner, Jonathan Sonis, for sparking my interest in the Technion. He is another testament that a world-class education here yields amazing results and pays unbelievable dividends. It is with great modesty I accept this honor, which is a continued celebration of the pioneers with the foresight and the determination to make research and science education a priority at this great institution. The common thread amongst our predecessors and peers is we won't accept the world as it is today, as change is always inevitable. Our goals are the perpetuity of the Technion's vision to make the discoveries of tomorrow and to share them globally, as well as to fortify the physical and financial security of Israel now and into the future. The Forman family's involvement is based on the fact that the Technion's past achievements and future direction has and will provide a better world for us all. Knowledge and education provides the potential for peace, and we see the greatest possibility to achieve this right here in Haifa, Israel. I want to acknowledge the love of my life, Tatiana, and my loving, wonderful children, Roman, Alexandra, Andre, and Philippe, my partners in this amazing journey. The relationships we have forged and the projects we've personally been involved with have made a real impact in sciences from medicine to aerospace. These issues are relevant to the world's most prolific challenges and the future of humankind. The Forman family's commitment to the Technion is unwavering, and we shall remain mishpacha into the future. I also want to mention a special thanks to my sister Margaret and her life partner Suzanne for joining us here today. In addition, I would like to acknowledge some dear friends from Gift of Life International, Rob Railman and Bill Curry, as well as a dear loving friend, Marty Hauser, and his lovely wife Jane, who are also in attendance here today that flew in from the United States to be here with us. It is clearly evident that the results of our collective efforts are making great things happen, and this is how we do it. Professor Levy. Ani mitchayev leTechnion u leMedinot Yisrael. And Mom, Dad, wherever you are up there looking down, you finally got a doctor in the family.
Congratulations, Dr. Forman. Thank you very much. I call on Professor Solomon W. Golomb of the United States to please rise. In tribute to your innovative contributions to the theory and practice of digital sequences, space communications, and spread spectrum communications, in recognition of your long service in university teaching and research, and in gratitude for your many years of commitment to the State of Israel and your support and cooperation with the Technion. Professor Stibi, please join the floor. So I now invite Professor Golomb to please respond.
President Peretz Lavi, Chairman of the Board of International Board of Governors, Lawrence Jackier, Chairman of the Council, Yoram Alster, and Moshe Spitalny, Dean of the Graduate School. Gvirotai, Rabotai, friends, relatives, fellow members of the Board of Governors, fellow honorees, oh my friends, ladies and gentlemen, Shalom Rav Lekulchem, my sincere greetings and best wishes to all of you. This honorary doctorate from the Technion means more to me than any other honor that I could imagine. This is not only because the Technion has exceptionally high standards, but also because of the fundamental role that the Technion plays in the economy, the defense, and indeed the very survival of Eretz Yisrael. When President Peretz Lavi called me last December to tell me that the relevant bodies of the Technion had voted to offer me this degree, I had serious doubts that I truly deserved it, but there was no way that I was going to turn it down. So here I am. It is also wonderful that this ceremony takes place in the presence of so many of my dearest friends, current and former members of the faculty, deans, presidents, and vice presidents of this great institution. My daughter, Dr. Beatrice Golomb, is here with me, and this is her second visit with me to the Technion. She was here 2 years ago also. I'm very honored that my sister, Edna Sharoni, is here. Edna was the first member of my immediate family to make Aliyah in 1947 and has lived in Eretz Israel ever since. She came to do graduate work at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem just in time for the War of Independence to break out. So she enlisted in the Israeli army and was part of the defense of the city of Jerusalem in the War of Independence. And she is accompanied here tonight with a number of her children and grandchildren. And her children, of course, are my nieces and nephews. And I translate nieces and nephews into Hebrew as nisim v'niflaot. I want to mention, I have two former postdocs who came to work with me after they got their doctorates here and returned to become faculty members. Avraham Lempel is here tonight, and Tuvi Etzion. And my dear friends on the faculty, Yaacov and Shoshana Ziv are here tonight, and it's hard for me to imagine having so many dear friends in the same place at the same time. I checked all my previous passports, and I discovered that this is my 25th visit to Eretz Yisrael, and on at least 15 occasions, this has included spending time at the Technion. I've given technical lectures here quite a few times. I could remember 1990, 1999, and as recently as this afternoon. So in light also of my friends on the faculty, my former postdocs, with all of and my service on the Board of Governors, maybe I've almost earned some sort of degree here, but I never imagined that I would receive this incredible honor. Again, sincerest thanks and best wishes to all of you. Thank you.
Having studied electrical engineering at the Technion, and I was told not to deviate too much from the text here, but I have to say that, having studied electrical engineering at the Technion, I cannot but stand in awe that so many of the people from whose books and from whose papers we learned and we studied here, we can actually see and meet and become friendly with. And actually, with Professor Zakai, once we had a discussion that I was surprised that many of the people we mentioned in courses, they are still alive. And he said, yes, you know, you think that if you have a book by somebody, he must be dead. The next is a very special honorary doctorate recipient for me. Please, I call upon Professor Thomas Kailath of the United States to please rise. For fair disclosure, I have to say that I was Professor Kailath's student at Stanford University. So it's a very special honor for me. In recognition of your outstanding scientific achievements through seminal contributions to information theory, detection and estimation, linear systems and control, array and signal processing, VLSI chip design and manufacturing, in appreciation for your education of a generation of leaders in science and engineering, in acknowledgement of your successful technology transfers to industry, and in gratitude for your cooperation with the scientific institutions of the State of Israel. I invite Moshe Sidi to please present the scroll. I now invite Professor Kailath to please respond.
Well, I would like to thank the Board of Governors, the Council, President Perez, and all others involved, especially my nominators and the references, for this very high honor from one of the leading technological universities in the world at this time. I would also like to thank my members of my family, my eldest daughter, Anne, who is here, her cousin, Rachel, and my youngest son, Ryan, as well as several colleagues from the Technion and other parts of Israel for being here today. I said that this is an honor from one of the most respected technological institutions in the world at this time. But of course, its fame and reputation did not suddenly appear overnight. It took a period of years, and I had a privileged view, I think, of, say, the growth of the electrical engineering department at the Technion. In a lighter vein, I should like to steal a line which Professor Golomb used on a different occasion. He said the Technion did not become so famous overnight. It got there by degrees, and not just honorary degrees. As important as they are. So my acquaintance with the Technion began in 1959 when a fellow graduate student at MIT was Jacob Ziv, who was then working at Raphael and was probably sent there by Dr. Epstein to MIT. So, Jacob and I were good friends, his wife Shoshana as well. And so when we finished our studies, Jacob came back to Israel, and then I think he moved from the Raphael to the Technion, and he invited me to visit in 1962. And it was a very interesting visit in many ways. If you know Jacob, we once went to the tourist office, and they, with Jacob, he took me for some visa issue. And they spoke to me, thinking I was the Sabra and Jacob the the foreigner. But of course, Jacob, you know, rose steadily in the ranks. He's well known in the Technion. He's well known in Israel. He was president of the Israel Academy of Sciences. And just in case you missed all these honors, as you drive towards the Technion, you'll see a sign, Ziv Neighborhood. Well, in 62, when I visited him, apart from the tourist incident, I had the great good fortune of meeting his close colleague, Professor Moshe Zakai, and his wife, Mita. And we have had actually a long association since then, including some very beautiful joint work, which I'm very proud of, actually. So thank you, Moshe. Yeah. How did I, you know, the rest of the story of the growth has both, for me, a plus side and in some small sense, a minus side as well. And I'll explain that in a way. Okay. You see, so from MIT, I had taken a leave of absence because I had a great desire to see Caltech. And fortunately, Professor Saul Golomb was a visitor at MIT, and he invited me to spend a year at JPL, which was part of Caltech. And so he was actually my first boss, and it's a pleasure to follow him to the stage here. Anyway, so instead of returning to MIT, you know, having bitten of the fruit of California, I never went back to MIT and stayed in California. And as a young professor there, you work by yourself and then with graduate students. And Ziv and Zakai had decided by then that Stanford was coming up in the world. And there was no longer any need to have Technion and Israeli students go so much only to MIT, but they should send some of them to Stanford with me. And the first one of these was Adrian Siegel, who came in, I think, 1970, 71, and is now, he returned to Israel and is now the Benjamin Professor of Communications and the Technion. After that, every couple of years, they would send me another stellar student, one of them in 80, and they went to different places, but in 1982, I think Boaz Porat, my student, came back to the faculty here. And then my next student was Professor Brookstein now, and he also, after a very nice and interesting experience with me, which he has spoken about, including both technical and non-technical, he came back to Israel. And I was expecting that the same tradition will continue. And in fact, Freddie had already lined up. He said, there's another next student in line. And I'd arranged a fellowship for him, research assistantship. But he didn't come. It seems that Moshe, who was his advisor at the time, said, enough already. We we don't need to send our students abroad. The Technion is well now capable of handling them. And so that's why I said the negative. I haven't had a brilliant Technion student since then. They've all stayed here and so on. Okay. Well, now you mentioned Freddie. I've had the pleasure and privilege of working in different fields. But I must say, I think the most important part, I feel, of my contributions is what was mentioned in the citation. I'm happy you did that. The opportunity I had to work with an array of brilliant students who, you know, it's a two-way street. You learn a lot from them and their challenges, and I hope my questioning of them has been one of the greatest experiences of my life. And I want to thank them here, and I want to thank all of you. Yes.
Thank you very much. Okay, next I would like to call upon Yaacov Kotlicki of Israel to please rise. In tribute to your contribution over many years to Israeli society and the Technion, in gratitude for your support of Technion initiatives to advance disadvantaged populations in general and young people in particular, in the framework of the Youth Activities section of the Technion Center for Pre-University Education, in appreciation for your generous support of the Technion's of Akim program, and in recognition of your service as a role model for Technion alumni. בהוקרה על תרומתך במשך שנים רבות לחברה הישראלית ולטכניון, ברחשי תודה על תמיכתך ביוזמות טכניוניות לקידום אוכלוסיות חלשות בכלל ולטיפוח בני נוער בפרט, במסגרת פעילויות אגף הנוער שבמרכז לחינוך קדם אקדמי בטכניון, ומתוך הכרה בתמיכתך בפרויקט אופקים להייטק, ובהיותך דוגמה ומופת לבוגרי הטכניון. פרופסור שפיטלני, the dean of the graduate school, to present the scroll. I now invite Mr. Kotlicki to please respond.
Dear friends, distinguished guests, family of the Technion, ladies and gentlemen. During the years 1966 to 1970, as a student, as a member of the Technion Symphonic Orchestra, I used to stand on this stage, somewhere here, week after week and play music. But I have never envisioned that 45 years later, I will be invited to this stage once again to perform, but this time as a member of another distinguished orchestra, my fellow honorees. I would like to thank the president of the Technion, Professor Peretz Lavi, the Senate of the Technion, the Board of Governors, and the Technion for conferring me with such a great honor. Exactly 100 years ago in the city of Kielce, Poland, my father, Elshad Tzvi Kotlicki, was born to a poor family of tinsmiths. When he was just 9 years old, his father died. My grandmother could not afford keeping my father at school, so he was sent to work as an apprentice with his uncle, a master painter of buildings. But my father was a very curious boy. He used to watch how the carpenter, the builder, the plumber, the electrician work, and also spent much time with the nearby shoemaker and watchmaker and the mechanist and the radio technician and photographer, etc., and watching how they repair things, but also learning how all those instruments are constructed and operate. As a young man, he became a master in painting, but also an expert in many other technical professions. In 1950, we immigrated to Israel. It was the period of austerity, the Tzena, that we were lucky enough to get a small laundry room on one of Tel Aviv roofs, which my father turned into a small apartment with all facilities, all built by himself. Paints and brushes were hard to find, so he produced them from powders, oils, and other raw materials that he found in the nearby flea market. It was Shuk Bezalel, you know, at that time. At school, I struggled with my Hebrew punctuation, so he built me a learning toy, a punctuation roulette. And when I started photographing, he built me a complete photocopying laboratory, including a photo enlarger and drying machines. As a result, during my 4 years here in the Technion, I became an official photographer of the Student Association and the manager of the photographic laboratory at the Student House. Besides building various tools and instruments, my father's passion was to repair what professionals gave up with. Family members and neighbors used to bring in various electrical and mechanical instruments, radios and watches, sewing machine, mixer, musical instruments and bicycles, everything considered beyond repair. And if a certain part was missing or broken, he produced one. And if it failed, he tried again and again and again until it finally worked. My room was next to the kitchen, where we used to eat, and in between was his tiny workshop, 1 meter by 1 meter only, the Werkstatt, where I used to Meisterwitch, as my mother used to call it. Many years later, when I was looking backward in time, I realized that I was actually grown in a research and development laboratory. I assume by now that you probably ask yourself, why I'm bothering you tonight with all these old stories, Mises and Geschäften, about my father. The reason is that when my father passed away, besides saying what a wonderful person he was, everyone talked about what a great engineer my father could be, would be, or would have been if only he had the opportunity to learn. As an engineer, and especially in the Technion, I can say that my father was the most multidisciplinary, self-contained person I ever met, always striving for excellency. And he had only 3 years of schooling. This great honor that you have bestowed upon me tonight is very much reflected of my father's legacy, and I am sharing it tonight with him. It's extremely meaningful for me, and for this, I am eternally grateful. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Last but not least, I now call upon Mr. Eitan Wertheimer of Israel to please rise. In recognition of your significant support of Israeli society and the Technion, in gratitude for your profound commitment to promoting education in Israel through your admirable leading role in the Atidim program, and in tribute to your contribution to projects for advancing education in Israel's disadvantaged and outlying communities, including the Technion Center for Pre-University Education Programs for Jewish Orthodox and Arab youth. בהוקרה על תמיכתך רבת המשמעות בחברה הישראלית ובטכניון, על מסירותך ומחויבותך האיתנה לקידום החינוך במדינת ישראל באמצעות מנהיגותך מעוררת הערכה בתוכנית עתידים, וברחשי תודה על תרומתך לפרויקטים חינוכיים המיועדים לקידום החינוך בפריפריה החברתית והגיאוגרפית, לרבות המכינה הטכניונית לצעירים מהמגזר החרדי והמכינה לצעירים מהמגזר הערבי. פרופסור שפיטלני, I invite you to present the scroll. I now invite Mr. Dr. Wertheimer to respond.
First, I want to thank the committee for electing to award me with this honor. But I must say very open, it's not me standing here. It's a lot of other wonderful people that I'm just representing them. Either people in our businesses, in ISCA or Blades or other elements all people in Atidim, or in Naam, or in the loan fund, Daroma Tzafona, or people in Rambam, and many other places. I was fortunate to be born to a wonderful family, wonderful father, wonderful mother. She's not there, unfortunately. And I have two good sisters and one wonderful brother. And I was lucky to find my hero in the house. My father became a hero also for many other people in the country, and I was very fortunate and I'm very happy he's here. The second important decision I made in my life was to convince my wife to get married with me, because we're pretty helpful. The rest is five children, a wonderful family. And as my father once came to him, asked him, how do you run a business? He told me, business you run from your kopf, family you run from your heart. But later I found out it's not enough. It's not enough, you also have to do other things. And I went to Warren Buffett and asked him, how you do your things? And he taught me the lesson, balancing between your kopf, your heart, and your pocket, and trying to keep it. Then I was fortunate enough to find another gentleman that asked me a little question, do you want to be the richest guy in the cemetery? You'll be dead anyhow. And then I started doing a lot of serious experimenting, which I still do today, and a long series of mistakes, trying to see, can I make an impact? Can I do something better? I joined Atidim after it was founded by General Mofaz and two wonderful people, Mr. Barazani and Tal Dilian from the army, when it was 3 months old. And last year we crossed the 22,000 young people in universities from the periphery. And we are dreaming to be 40,000, 50,000. We're starting to work today on preparing for social entrepreneurship and for economical entrepreneurship, with microbanking, a purpose to make sure we make success all the way. I was fortunate and very fortunate to find the Technion as a home for most of Atidim program, because we needed a good home. We can help a little bit, but we needed the knowledge and the father and the mother for the whole thing. Later, we came also with many other programs. I'm very fortunate to work also with the Technion, with the Rambam project, and very successful. Also, it's a long one. Trying to combine economical model into philanthropy to make it ever long-lasting model to see if it works, and it so far works wonderful. And I'm very, very grateful to the Technion being our home and our mama in this area. It's rather peculiar a little bit that a professor for sleep, Peretz Lavi is a professor for sleep, has a task to wake up the future in the everlasting world of education, that every time you do something, you know, you have to do the next story because the world evolves and learning belongs to the future. Our knowledge belongs to the past anyhow. I would like to say here that besides being honored, and I'm very thankful, and I'm very honored to be with this fine group of people, I would like to dream. I would like to dream about welfare and justice that will embrace the whole people with economical success between Benghazi and Baghdad. I would like to dream that peace will conquer every square meter and every heart between Benghazi and Baghdad in a real way. I would like to dream that we'll find how to bring the keys for that formula, which lies in knowledge transferred into application, transferred into success, into technology. And I hope to see economies, knowledge-based economy, emerge in those countries, because we all dream about Israel in the next 100 years. I dream that Israel and the Technion in the next 100 years will be the sugar in the world milk. And I want to say that my job is to try to plant trees so other people will sit in their shade. And I'm very, very fortunate to be part of wonderful people that I just represent them and that do a wonderful job, and your applause is the applause for them. And thank you for honoring me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I again wish to express our deepest appreciation to all the honorees and indeed to all the Technion's friends who have come from all over the world to demonstrate their solidarity with the Technion and Israel on this wonderful occasion. Thank you very much. Will the audience now please rise for the Hatikvah?